By now, we're used to autobiographies from film stars. The least successful they are, the more lurid their reminiscences usually. But one actor has not only been a screen hit longer than he probably cares to remember, he's also been a hit with the critics for his sensitive volumes of autobiography. This year, Dirk Bogarde moved from autobiography to publish his first novel, A Gentle Occupation. And Elaine asked him about the difference between writing fact and fiction.
Your first two volumes of autobiography, perhaps they're your last volumes of autobiography.
It's possible.
Based upon fact, mm-hmm. This, your very first published novel, fiction, is there any very crisp line between those two things? Surely there's some fiction in autobiographies or fictional techniques.
Very intellectual. I'm not very good at all these questions. There are techniques, there's no fiction in an autobiography, not, at least not in mine. There is selectivity.
Yes.
Which is a different thing. It means yes. You choose to put into your book of your life the things in your life that matter most and get rid of the stuff that didn't matter or that you don't want exposed. With fiction, of course, it's quite a different thing. You can do what you like. But there is no biographical stuff in this book, this fictional book. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes.
But I haven't leaked. The one doesn't bleed into the other.
But you did use some of the things that actually happened within Java, didn't you?
Oh, yes, that is true. I mean, I used, naturally. And there are portions of people from all over the world that I knew. Phrases and behavior and things like that, once put together, invented all these people and built up out of 1,000 bricks that were other things that you'd found all over the world. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. In different parts of life. Things that happened in the European part of my war, I've transposed and put into the island sequence. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm not very sure what I'm saying.
Well, no, in other words, you use every resource that you have at hand.
That you lay your hands on, yes.
In the act of creation.
That's right.
And that, I suppose, applies if you're an actor too, when you're acting.
It applies if you're anything. It applies if you're anything creative. If you're a writer, if you're a musician, if you write music, or if you're a painter. And certainly if you're an actor, it's observation and awareness and hearing things said that you remember and completely and control for yourself and whole and use.
You obviously observe with great clarity, and often you use a painter's name to describe the mood of a scene.
Yes, I did.
A sort of visual shorthand so that it comes alive if you're lucky enough to know the painter.
That's the trouble, yes.
And also with dialogue, the term actor's dialogue is a compliment, isn't it?
From you, at this point, it is, yes.
But it means that it sounds the way people do speak instead of the way people write what they think.
Yes,
people
it isn't literary dialogue. I know that I was criticized for that when it was in manuscript form. And they said, you know, it's not very good literature, your dialogue. And I said, well, dialogue and conversation is not good literature, usually. Maybe it is amongst dons in Oxford or in Cambridge, but it isn't amongst ordinary people. We use all kinds of mumble-jumbled grammatical errors and phrases, but they're real.
And short phrases.
And short phrases, and repeats, and overlaps, and all that kind of thing. And when I was writing, I mean, some people say it must be a very solitary profession, writing. It's no way solitary, because I invented 14 people. They lived with me for 14 months, day and night, hour after hour. And I said every single line that I ever wrote. I played aloud to myself, like a sort of crazy actor, which indeed was what I am. So heaven knows what the sheep thought on the mountain, because I was playing every scene until it came off my mouth and I replied to myself, so the dialogue was a duologue.
People believe that the novelist must have a certain arrogance, because what
Why?
He is saying is, I know something about the world that is important that I will share with you, something new. There has to be some arrogance.
Well, I don't think, why in the name of God must there be arrogance about sharing something new with people? That is the most exciting thing that I can think of doing. That's what I try to do in all the films I've been doing, the few films that I've done in the last 10 years, is to share an extraordinary thing with someone, like with Death in Venice, where I was sharing an experience which I know didn't apply so much to middle-aged people as it did to young people. I had no idea that Death in Venice was a film about intense loneliness, and that loneliness was something that only the young really understand.
What?
When you're middle-aged, we seem to, one could be very lonely. But young people are very often desperately lonely. They can't meet elder people to talk about things. They don't find anyone to talk to things about younger than themselves. They haven't anything with their contemporaries. They're usually bewildered and lost to some degree. I know from the letters I've had that Death in Venice symbolized for them the essence of search for something beautiful. Again, a question of survival. And go and get it. You know, we used to have a phrase in our family, get it if you want it. So get it, whatever happens, get what you wanted. That's why when I saw the film in two or three places in Europe, I've never seen it in England, the whole audiences of young people would stand applauding when von Aschenbach makes up his mind, hell with it, I'm going back to the beach to in quest of my beauty. Whatever happens, if I die from cholera, whatever happens in the world, I'm going back. I'm going to beauty. And that used to happen every time. I couldn't believe it.
And being in the middle of this must have been almost food for your soul to see how the audience responds.
It is food, soul food, if you want. That's the real essence of it. That's why I cannot understand your phrase, that you must be arrogant if you're sharing something that is new.
Perhaps
you can't be arrogant about doing something.
All novelists, when they sit down, must play God because they create a complete new world peopled by people that they've created.
Yes, but God didn't create people, I don't think, did he? Well, we won't go on to that. Well, I don't know. I'm a baby. I'm a novice. I'm teaching myself how to write with the cloth book, you know. It's ABC. I don't know how to write a book. I never have in my life put anything together longer than an 8-page letter.
I think it's a great
so maybe
success
I'll learn.
In every level. And
well,
I thank you very much, Dirk Bogarde. Does this mean that we will only see your name on book covers from now on instead of in front of movie theaters?
Well, it is a gentle occupation. I do like it. I'm hooked on words now. I love the people that I have to work with now in publishing. To work with intelligent people again is great.